propaganda model tries to do is stipulate a set of institutional, ideological variables that reflect this elite power and that powerfully influence the media.
Herman and Chomsky use the metaphor of filters. There's all this information out there, but only some of it gets through. Now, of course, the use of filters is inevitable. The news has to select and edit information. But that filtering isn't just a question of free journalistic judgment. It's heavily influenced by a series of institutional pressures, such as who owns the media, the role of advertisers, the kinds of sources that are used, and a more direct form of pressure that Herman and Chomsky call flack. Key question in any democracy is what makes it through the filters and what gets filtered out.
Now, if you look at the agenda-setting media, what are they? Well, in the first place, they're huge corporations, parts of even bigger corporations like, you know, Westinghouse and so on. So they are subparts of huge concentrations of private power.
We're used to thinking of these huge corporations that run the media as large, faceless entities, but they're actually run by people with opinions and a very specific set of interests. And a few of them might be liberal on some issues that don't affect the bottom line, like abortion. But when it comes to the bulk of issues, they're significantly more conservative than most Americans.
When we talk about media ownership and control, we're talking about the ownership and control by very wealthy people who have interlocking directorships with many other corporations. Now, very often they don't intervene in a gross way, but in, for example, Lawrence Grossman, who was the president of NBC, in his autobiography mentions that the GE chairman of the board, Jack Welch, pointed to him and said, "Remember, you work for General Electric Corporation." Now, in the case of hands-on owners like Rupert Murdoch, they obviously come in and impose an overall policy on their subsidiaries.
It's in the nature of the media business, regardless of technology, that proprietors can run the show in this way.
When Rupert Murdoch takes over the London Times and the Sun in London and the New York Post, the policies change markedly. Editors are put in who will meet Rupert Murdoch's conservative biases. In fact, in England, there's another very powerful media entrepreneur named Conrad Black, who controls the 50% of the newspapers in Canada, owns about 100, over 100 papers in the United States, including the Chicago Sun-Times. Like Murdoch, he's a very conservative man. Their power is so great that when Tony Blair became head of the Labour Party, he actually went to Australia to visit Murdoch and to try to convince Murdoch that he had proper credentials. And he convinced Murdoch, and in the last election, Murdoch actually supported the Labour Party and Tony Blair over the Conservative Party. Part of the reason for that was that, surprisingly enough, the Conservative Party had proposed some limit on a concentration in the British media, and Murdoch was reportedly furious at this. Now, the Labour Party had even a more stringent proposal, but at Blair's insistence, it was dropped.
Well, Rupert Murdoch changed his mind. He likes to back a winner, and there's a sort of implicit understanding between Mr. Blair and Mr. Murdoch that since the Murdoch press treated Mr. Blair kindly during the election, Mr. Blair will treat Mr. Murdoch kindly now that he's in power.
So here you have an amazing case of policy imposed, and with such force that great leaders have to come and genuflect to Murdoch.
TCI is the nation's largest cable provider, a kind of gatekeeper that decides which channels get carried and which don't get carried. As you can imagine, that makes them a very powerful part of the media system. TCI is owned by a man called John Malone. He gets right-wing channels like the National Empowerment Channel onto his cable system, but he can and does keep out any left-wing equivalent.
One thing that's always interested me is how the conservative critics of the media, who allege that the media are liberal, have a tendency to ignore ownership. They sort of pretend that the media are controlled by Dan Rather and Peter Jennings and these people down at the bottom of the power hierarchy in the media.
We're entering the new millennium with just a few huge companies, Time Warner, ABC, Disney, Murdoch's News International, Viacom, that own not just the news media, but the entire culture, from record labels to magazines to film studios to cable TV stations. We've seen a massive concentration of power in other industries too, but with media, the dangers of that narrowing are much more troubling. Another important filter is advertising. As they say, he who pays the piper calls the tune. In a commercial media system, the person who pays is the advertiser. Magazines get about 50% of their revenue from advertising, press gets about 80%, and with radio and TV, it's pretty much close to 100%. If you run a news organization, these are people you can't afford to offend.
Like other corporations, they sell a product to a market. In their case, the market is advertisers, other businesses. The product is audiences. Well, if you just look at the basic institutional structure of that system, and a rational person will ask, what kind of news and interpretation is going to come out of this? Well, the picture of the world that's going to come out is going to be one that's supportive to the needs and interests of the sellers, the buyers.
In its impact on the media, advertisers affect them mainly by wanting a proper environment. They don't intervene directly too often, but mainly they tell the media what they want. The media are in fact soliciting them. They know what they want, so there's a constant interplay. But sometimes programs are produced that they don't like ex post, and they come along and they complain. In the case, for example, this little newspaper had an article on automobile buying and said that this is a seller's market, and the new car dealers are asking for a 7.5% profit margin, but if you're smart and bargain with them, you can get it down to half that. And the auto dealers in the area were furious, and they raised Cain, they complained, they started an advertising boycott, and the publisher, this little newspaper, issued a public apology and said they were all wrong. One station manager of a TV station in Boston was quoted a year or so ago saying that since auto advertisements are about 25% of local advertising, it is an unwritten rule that you will never discuss buying autos and make any critique of the process of buying autos. It's an unwritten rule.
The Chrysler Company, for example, they sent out a letter to the magazines they advertise in. Chrysler's a big company, so that's a lot of magazines. And that letter insisted that they send their articles to Chrysler in advance so that they could screen them in order to see if they were suitable. If they didn't like the articles, they'd pull the ads. It's what we might call corporate censorship.
Some of the prime advertisers actually have a powerful influence on public broadcasting, too, because in the desire to curb public broadcasting, to keep it within proper bounds, conservatives have kept its funding in short supply. During the Reagan years, there was a real, very sharp cutback of funding for PBS and a real attempt to push them into the commercial nexus. So who comes into the picture to fund PBS? Well, the advertising community.
Welcome to Mobile Masterpiece Theatre. For nearly 30 years, we've been proud to provide the energy that helps public television run.
What has happened over the years in PBS is that their regular public affairs programs have become very conservative dominated, and it's partly because there's money there that will fund those programs. General Electric, which has its own network, funds the McLaughlin show, which is on every week, and Tony Brown, a black Republican, who's on every week. So that even on PBS, which is supposed to be the focal point of liberalism, conservatives dominate. One could argue that the evolution of the American television system is really a case study in the evolution of what happens when you have advertising dominating a media system. Another important filter is sourcing. The media depend on a steady stream of news, and they come to rely on powerful sources who can give them this regular news. The media locate reporters with regular beats to these primary news sources.
David Martin, CBS News, the Pentagon.
Bob Schieffer, CBS News at the Capitol.
John Donvan, ABC News at the White House.
If there's some source that gives out news every day or regularly, and this source is credible so that you can offer the news without worrying about whether it's going to be even true or false, that's very economical. We recently had this experience with Mr. Clinton's calling of this voluntarism summit.
We need an era of big citizenship. That is why we are here.
He announced that voluntarism was taking a new importance in the United States, and he got some very important dignitaries like General Colin Powell to be one of the sponsors. It had headlines day after day on this marvelous, wonderful event. It was made newsworthy by the fact that the President of the United States was pushing it and got dignitaries. Its substance was not given close attention. And of course, there were protesters at the summit convention, but they were marginalized, although they're making a very, very little good point, namely that the people who were sponsoring the conference had just passed a ghastly so-called welfare reform bill that was going to push millions of people into the need for volunteers. So it was, in a sense, a huge hypocritical operation. But the media took it at face value because it was peddled by dominant sources, primary definers who define what was news.
Journalists are not supposed to express their opinions. Opinions are supposed to be on editorial pages. On the front page you have news. But of course, everyone who thinks knows that's mostly meaningless. Journalists do express opinions, but they don't put them in their own words. So the way to express an opinion is to go to an expert and ask the expert, what do you think about such and such? And then you quote the expert. That's not your opinion. You're quoting the expert. It's objective. But of course, you choose the experts properly so that they will express the acceptable opinions.
There's a question, there's always the problem, who is going to be the experts? It could be that dissidents would be experts. Since that presents a problem, conservatives have frequently organized think tanks at which experts will be cultivated who meet the conservative standard. Institutions like the Georgetown Center for Strategic and International Studies is a think tank that specialized in international affairs. And it was in a revolving door relationship with the CIA and the State Department. Same thing has been true of the American Enterprise Institute, which is a very important corporate-funded think tank that sponsors economists and political scientists and others who are very conservative and speak the corporate line.
There have been a number of studies of the experts who are used by the news media. Time and time again, the people who come out on top in these studies are right-wingers. One of the recent studies looked at all the think tanks quoted by major media in 1995. Top of the list, cited over 2,000 times, came the Heritage Foundation. The Heritage Foundation makes no pretense of being anything other than a voice of conservative right-wing thought. In fact, what this study showed was that three of the top four on the list were solidly conservative, corporate-funded think tanks. In total, 51% of the citations were from conservatives, 41% were from moderates, think tanks like the Brookings Institute or the Council on Foreign Relations, and only 7.5 were from experts coming from a progressive or left-of-center perspective. What's interesting is that the voices that are excluded are often actually more in tune with American public opinion, whether it's on social policy or government spending priorities, than groups like the Heritage Foundation or the Cato Institute.
So you have really a closed system in which The sourcing is the government, the power of powerful sources at the government level, and then they're complementary, quote, independent experts. It's a beautiful system. Flack is a filter that means negative feedback. Flack really is important when it comes from people who can really threaten the media effectively.
If you want to write a story about, say, the military system, you go to the Air Force, they have a huge publicity system, they're very nice, they'll give you all the data and do the work and the right ideas. If you just, you change a few words maybe, if you follow that script, you'll never get into any difficulty. On the other hand, if you begin to challenge any of these things, you will get into problems.
Some years ago, the Chicago Tribune hired a man from the military who was an ex-Marine named David Evans. He was their military reporter. And David Evans knew a lot about the Pentagon, and he was an honest man. He wasn't a flunky of the Pentagon. He was an old veteran, obviously incredibly loyal to his country, but he didn't believe that the Pentagon always told the truth, and therefore the Pentagon didn't like him at all. So the Chicago Tribune's publisher was being constantly assailed by the public relations department of the Pentagon and the contractors, and eventually David Evans was fired. Another form of flack that's very important now and very obvious is libel suits. A company like Philip Morris, for example, going after ABC for having made allegations about nicotine manipulation in cigarettes, caused ABC eventually to settle on a very apologetic terms.
Tonight, for the second time in a week, a major broadcast network will apologize to the tobacco industry.
We apologize to our audience, Philip Morris and Reynolds.
The other major kind of flack that should be mentioned explicitly is the organizations that have been organized mainly by the right-wing foundations to monitor and discipline the media on a continuing basis. The most notable is Accuracy in Media, and is funded by corporate money, and it monitors the media and writes letters and threatens.
I told the chairman of the New York Times, the editorial page editor, the other day that now is the time to have a proper investigation.
There are basically three kinds of flak. One, pressure from government, which is particularly important for, say, defense or foreign policy issues. Two, pressure from corporations. And thirdly, pressure from corporate-funded right-wing pressure groups like Accuracy in Media. What's notable is that on issues where it counts, all the pressure comes from the right, not from the left. And that might be why we hear so much about this mythical creature, the liberal media, because we hear people complaining from the right, but not from the left. So what emerges from this systematic analysis is that the idea of the liberal media is a myth. In fact, once you do a systematic analysis of media institutions, the whole idea of a liberal media really begins to look rather silly. The media owners, the advertisers, the news shapers, the news makers, and the powerful groups who put pressure on the media, they all represent interests that go from the middle of the road to very conservative. A left-wing or liberal media clearly goes against their interests, and they control the media.